Hi everyone and welcome to another video. For today I have a Lenovo ThinkCentre M900 SFF here with me. During the video I will completely disassemble this machine, then reassemble it again and while doing so also perform a few minor upgrades. I will upgrade the memory to 16GB and replace the hard disk with an SSD. These two relatively small and cheap upgrades will make a world of difference for today's usage. Once all of that is done, I also plan to run some benchmarks to see how this device still performs in today's world. The M900 I have here is the SFF or small form factor version. It was also available in a tiny form factor or a regular tower version. The SFF is somewhere between, not too small and still easy to work on or upgrade, and not too big and loud either. Using the serial number, I can see that this M900 was bought about 6 years ago and came with the following configuration. At first glance, this is still accurate. Let us start by having a look at the external. In general, the design, to my idea at least, is pretty nice, clean and modern. But this design is not only visually nice, it seems that the M900 was built to military spec, allowing this machine to perform in humid environments, extreme temperatures, withstand vibration, dust and more. That's not something I'm going to test though. At the front of the case, we can find the power button, two USB ports, front audio and a slim DVD writer. As you can see, the case has rubber feet on the bottom and side, so it can be used either as a classic desktop or standing up like a tower. On the back, we can see the power supply, serial port, VGA, 2x display port, 6 more USB ports, Ethernet, and audio. Opening up the case is done by removing two thumb screws, which my machine only has one remaining, and then you can slide open the top cover. Inside, we can see the DVD drive and hard disk, which seem to be held in place with a piece of paper somehow. And here is the CPU cooler and 210 watt power supply. To get access to the rest, you first need to release the DVD drive and slide it a bit backwards to free up the blue clip on the left side. Then you can swing the drive bay forward. The fan duct can also be easily removed with the two clips holding it in place. As you can see, that gives us better access to the memory and PCIe slots. Let's start by getting the drives out next. I'll start with the hard disk. Somehow, the original drive caddy is no longer there and some paper was used to keep the drive in its place. The capacity and date of the drive seems to match, but the spare number sticker, which is clearly from HP, gives away that the hard disk is not original. If you have the original and optional drive caddy, which goes under the DVD drive, the case is able to house a 2.5-inch and a 3.5-inch drive. But in emergency, you can always use the manual of your Jabra headset as well. Removing the DVD drive is easy. Just disconnect the cables and get it out. Now, to free up the motherboard, I'll remove everything connected to it first. Like the SATA cables and SATA power connectors. As you can see, power for SATA goes through the motherboard and does not come directly from the power supply. Also, keep in mind that only a single standard SATA power connector is available by default. Next, we have everything for the front panel, front USB, the LEDs, front audio, speaker, and front fan. Followed by the power connectors, P4, 10-pin power input, and a thermal sensor. At this point, the motherboard is free and we can unscrew it from the case. It's held into place with 8 screws. Also, because the CPU fan is fixed to the bottom of the case, we need to get that one out at this stage as well. The thermal paste is in pretty good condition actually at first sight, but I'll get it replaced anyway later. Almost there, but typical mistake here, as there is always that one screw which is good at hiding itself. That's better, and now we're able to get the board out of the case. Let us take a better look at it. We have the CPU socket with CPU still installed, one DIMM installed in the four memory slots, PCIe X16, X4 and PCIe X1, front audio, PC speaker, second serial port, and this is an M2 connector that allows for an optional adapter card. Not for Wi-Fi or storage as is typical for such slot, but for a PCI adapter. Having this adapter would allow you to install an old legacy PCI card, so not to be confused with the more recent PCI Express. Further, we have additional USB port headers and the one used for the front USB ports. 4 SATA ports, front LEDs, system fan, auxiliary fan, and CPU fan. For power, we have the 10-pin power connector, P4 connector, and the output for SATA power connectors. And finally, on top here, this is for the thermal sensor. As we saw, only one DDR4 DIMM of 4GB is installed. We'll upgrade this, as that's definitely on the low side for using this PC today. The CPU, which we can easily get out of the socket, is an i5-6500. In contrast to the memory, this one is still fine. If you would also like to upgrade the CPU, as far as I could find, the fastest CPU that is supported by this motherboard is an i7-6700. Now, before we start to reassemble, I put out everything here nicely. We have the motherboard, CPU, 2x8GB of DDR4, CPU cooler, DVD drive, SSD, fan duct, and SATA cables. First of all, I'll put back the CPU in the socket. Then we can install the memory. In total, there are 4 memory slots operating in 2 channels. As we have 2 equal DIMMs, we best populate slot 2 and 4. A single DIMM would go in slot 2, as was the case. That's done, so now we can put the board back into the case and get it fixed. Then some fresh thermal paste on the CPU. And we can reinstall the cooler. After also connecting the CPU fan, let's continue with the cables to the motherboard. We are almost done here. As I don't have a bracket for the SSD, I'll just connect it and leave it in place where the original drive was. Finally, we can put back the DVD drive and get it connected as well. And last but not least, the fan duct, which I almost forgot honestly. After closing up the case, we can test if everything still works. As this is a new SSD, there is no operating system installed, so this error is totally as expected. Let's have a look at the BIOS first. The system summary shows us the i5-6500, 16GB of RAM, the new SSD and DVD drive. All pretty much as we would expect, which is good. To continue, let me install a fresh copy of Windows 11. That went pretty fluent. Now let me connect the PC to the network and install updates and missing drivers. Installing all updates took a longer time than the actual installation, but all seems fine now. About this PC shows us again what we already knew. And the same goes for Task Manager. Everything, as we would expect, is there. Time for some benchmarks, starting with Geekbench 5. $3,134. Not too bad. Actually, that's higher than what I expected or could find at least on Google before doing the video. Together with the SSD and 16GB of RAM, this should give a nice and fluent experience to work with, as long as you're not gaming at least. Since it's the first time that I'm using this SSD type, let me test performance of it as well. That looks good. Performance as would be expected from a SATA SSD. Probably easily 5 to 6 times as fast as the hard drive that was originally in there. As a last test, let me run Browser Bench. This gives us a good impression of the day-to-day performance for this PC. No surprise here either, just proper performance, confirming a bit what we already knew. That's all I have for this video. Thanks a lot for watching. I really hope you enjoyed this, and if you did, please put a like. Don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel for more of the same. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.